Hi, and welcome to Books Beauty Kendra. My name is Kendra, and today I wanted to do a then versus now kind of video. So this is what I used to read, and what I would recommend to, like, the children, middle grade area now. So, yeah. What I read as a child. I was very much into fantasy. Always into fantasy. That's not much changed, except now I also read romance. But, like, that's not appropriate for little ones. So, let's start with the books that I did read when I was little. Keep in mind, these are just a few, because I started reading very young, by myself. Like, I learnt through other people, but, like, I read by myself at a young age. And yeah, so there'd be a lot more on this list, but, like, these are the ones I could find in a quick search around the house. First one being a very controversial pick. Well, now it is. It didn't used to be. It used to be the biggest. It probably still is one of the biggest book series ever. And that is Harry Potter. This is Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone by J.K. Rowling. You don't talk about her. And it follows Harry Potter. This is the old cover. It's the 25th anniversary edition. I've also got this actual cover in another room, because, like, that's what I read when I was growing up. Like, the originals. Not like one of the new covers they have, the many new covers they have now. And this follows Harry Potter as he learns that he's a wizard. He is a wizard. Yes. And it's full of magic and whimsy and such great life lessons the whole series round. I will tell you a funny story about this. When I started reading this when I was 5, so very, very young. And I was like, who is this person? Why are they trying to take Harry away from his family? This is Hagrid, of course, the half-giant. And I put it down. Put it down, didn't pick it up for another 3 years. When I was 8, picked it up again, fell in love. So that's Harry Potter. Then I've got my favourite book from, I think, about the ages of 6 or 7 to about 8, 9, until, like, I was reading the Harry Potter series, and then that became my favourite. Does not live up now, let's just say that. I'll tell you in a moment. It's The Two Princesses of Bamar by Gail Carson Levine. This is just, like, you can see how old. I've read this so many times. Follows two princesses and a wizard, so there's three. The wizard is the love interest, who's, like, over 100 years old. She's, like, 15, 16 years old. I don't know why I was reading this at 7 years old, but, like, even then the romance creeped me out, because that was a big age difference. Yes, anyways. The younger sister goes on a quest because there's, like, this big magical disease that's going around that the older sister gets. So the younger sister goes off on a quest with the wizard to find, like, a way to cure it. And it's got a whole bunch of different mystical creatures. There are giants in here. I think this is the one with the giants. Or am I thinking of, like, Ella Enchanted. No, I think it's this one. Ella Enchanted is the same author, I think. Anyways, this was my favourite book for, like, a few years, and I read it multiple times. Loved it. Does not hold up now. Like, it's just not very good. Next is a very popular series. Oh, jeez. Those ones have a bit of mold on them. Ooh. These ones don't. These ones do not have. No. They don't have mold. And that is the Hunger Games series by Suzanne Collins, starting with The Hunger Games, Catching Fire, and Mockingjay. So this follows Katniss Everdeen as she goes into the 74th, yes, because the second book is about the 75th Hunger Games, 74th Hunger Games, and it's about her way of surviving this horrible, horrible game. I read this when I was like mid-teenager, I think. Oh, I haven't got the Twilight series on here. I couldn't be bothered getting them down. They're just... I don't like them now. I loved them when I read them. These ones, I think they'd hold up. These are much better. Anyways, it's about her trying to survive these horrible, horrible games while people watch on and either support or hate her. And it's a great series. Dark, so if you're a young one, maybe you don't read it. If you're a bit older, go ahead, do it. These are the ones that are a bit moldy or a bit burnt. I don't know. Anyways, it is the Children of the Red King series. I've only got the two. I don't know if there's any more. This is by Jenny Nimmo. The first one being Midnight for Charlie Bone. Look how cool that cover is. You don't see covers like that anymore. I think this takes place in a magical house. Or a magical school in his house. No, it's a magical house. And yeah. He has to basically... This one's about a school. This one's about a house. He has to basically survive. And it was a good fun time. He makes friends along the way. And he's got a horrible aunt. It's fun. Just don't read my copies because they've got questionable stuff on them. Next is an Australian author. So I am very happy about that I read this. That's The Flood's Neighbours. As in, that's the series title is The Flood's. This one's called The Neighbours by Colin Thompson. This is about a family of different mythical creatures. Like, it's got at the back the family. Ooh, don't break the book. Family files. It's just a fun time, and it like explains to you why you don't see any of these creatures around, even though they live on your street. It's a fun time. I loved this book when I was little. Been thinking about getting more of them. But yeah. The penultimate, I think. Yep, penultimate series. This is not in order. Let me try and get it in some sort of order. I think. And that is Artemis Fowl by Ian Colfer. Again. There's a rainbow. This is about fairies and this genius boy who's got a lot of money at his disposal looking for fairies so that he can find his father. And it's a bit sad in that case, but it's a lot of fun and he makes friends with some of the fairies and gnomes and magical creatures along the way. And it's amazing. The last book series that I've got, I don't know if there's more than these two, but like I have only read the two, and that is the Chinese Cinderella books. So this one's Chinese Cinderella, The Secret of an Unwanted Daughter by Adeline Yen Ma, and then Chinese Cinderella and the Secret Dragon Society. I don't remember much about these books. There's one scene that's very vividly stuck in my head about her drinking tea, and there's a bunch of children and an old lady, and the old lady is like, here, drink this tea. So they all drink the tea and they all the other children know what's going on. She does not. And I can't remember the Cinderella's name. But yeah, they keep drinking, and then she finds a cockroach at the bottom of it. And that's just stuck in my head. So, but it's very sad, very moving, very, very good books. And just, she's so sweet looking. And she just looks so sad. Yeah, those are some of the books that I read when I was much younger. Much, much, much younger. Probably too young for some of them. And yeah, let's get on to the books that I would recommend today for, like, either myself when I was at that age, or children who are going into that middle grade age. Now, there is one notable exclusion on this list, and that is Alice in Wonderland. I love Alice in Wonderland. I don't know if I would recommend it to very young children because it might be a bit scary, confusing, weird, all of the above. But, like, it's my favorite book, or one of my favorite books. So, yeah. If whimsical, like overly whimsical and magical and weird things sound like an interest to either yourself or a young person in your life, then do Alice in Wonderland. But, like, these two stacks of books that I have here, I think are much more suited for that age range. And we're going to start with my favourite middle grades. That's the Eva Evergreen series. So we've got Eva Evergreen Semi-Magical Witch by Julie Ave, and Eva Evergreen and the Cursed Witch. This is like a Kiki's Delivery Service retelling about Eva Evergreen, who has only a pinch of magic, and her trying to save this town from, is it called The Reckoning? I think it's called The Reckoning. Anyways, she, to help the town, she does like magical fixes, like small magical fixes to help them. And it's just a really sweet story about people coming to believe in her, her believing in herself. This one follows that story about like what's causing the, is it the reckonings? Who knows? The big events that happen every few years in this world. Next, we have The House with Chicken Legs by Sophie Anderson. Yes, this is like a Baba Yaga retelling, and it just follows the Marinka. Yeah, and her grandmother Baba Yaga. Baba Yaga's house has chicken legs, and it's Marinka trying to create a home for herself somewhere. But never having the ability to stay for very long in one place at a time. It's sweet, it's a little bit sad at times, but I remember a little bit better. I remember liking it a lot when I read it. That's a good one, and it's like a standalone, so you don't have to really. Oh, she's got more books, and I think they're kind of connected, but it's a standalone, so you don't have to read them all. I've only read, for the next one, the first book in this series. I keep meaning to go back and read more, but can never do. And that is Front Desk by Kelly Yang. This follows Mia Tang, and she helps her parents run this motel. I think it's a motel? Yeah. The motel's owned by someone else, but her parents run it and she helps them, and she basically wants to get a better life for herself and her parents, and she wants to become a writer, so she enters into this competition where she could gain a lot of money writing. And it's about the friendship she has and the friendship she makes, and doing what's right and it's another one of my favorites. It's a beautiful story. Then we've got a very well-known, oh my goodness, children's book series that who knows when the fourth book will come out. But this is again an Australian author. And none of these match, really. Oh, no, the Earth and the Two match. But this is the Nevermore series. We've got Nevermore, The Trials of Morrigan Crow by Jessica Townsend. We have Wondersmith, The Calling of Morrigan Crow. And Hollowpox, The Hunt for Morrigan Crow. Let's go back to the first one. The first one, Nevermore, The Trials of Morrigan Crow, follows Morrigan Crow. Her name's starting to not feel like real words. And she lives in like a normal city, like what you and I would live in, except there they have like these bad luck children, or unlucky children, one of the two. And basically anything that happens that's bad in that city or region, it's all blamed on that one child because of when they were born. Morrigan is one of those children. And then one day she's swept away to the world of Nevermore, where she finds out that she might have some magical powers that no one else knows about, not even herself. Jupiter something. Jupiter North comes and takes her away and becomes her benefactor and kind of like person who looks after her, caregiver. Becomes her caregiver in this world and helps her to make friends. Well, she makes friends herself. And it's got a bunch of different mysteries. It's very sweet. There's a giant talking cat over here. I'm covering her face, so sorry. And yeah, it's... If you loved Harry Potter as a child, try reading the Nevermore series. I'm sure many people have told you that. But yeah, it's a great series. Australian as well. So, good on you. Then I have this very fun edition. Look at that. Look at those spray dashes. Of Frostheart by Jamie Littler. I've only read the first book. The second book is up there, that green book there, I think. Yeah. And this follows a boy, Ash. I should know that. I watched Gavin Hetherington. I should know his name. Ash, as him and his guardian, who's like a yeti called Tobu. It follows them as Ash tries to discover where his parents are, because his parents left him when he was very young. He's still very young, but younger. And he's trying to figure out where they went to, what happened to them. And yeah, it's set in this world where it's covered in ice and snow, and there are leviathans living in the ground and will come and like the towns are all separated, or the cities are all separated, so they rely on the these ships to come and sail between them. But the ships are always in danger by the leviathan trying to get them. Ash and Tobu join a crew on one of these ships as they try and figure out how to find his parents. Yes, that was very convoluted, Kendra. But it's fun. It's a very fun time. Then I have Amari and the Night Brothers by B.B. Alston. This follows Amari as she tries to find her brother who went missing. And again, I have the second book. It's up there somewhere. I haven't read it yet because I've not been in a middle grade mood. But when I am, going back to this series. And basically Amari, in her quest to find her brother, ends up becoming like finding this briefcase that her brother has left her and joining this magical like academy sort of thing, magical school, where she finds out that she's like this super powerful person. Yeah. This book contains classified and magical information. Do not read without the proper permissions. You've been warned. Next, I've got the first two books in the series. I've got the other two up there again. Middle grade mood, not coming for me. These are more books for if you like the scarier things in life, or like slightly scary things, and you're a chicken like me. And that is the Small Spaces series by Katherine Arden, starting with Small Spaces. This one takes place in autumn. Yes. Then we have Dead Voices. Easily the creepiest thing I've ever read happens in this book. This one takes place in winter. Then there's Deep Waters, I think, and that's the spring. And then Empty Smiles is summer. And yeah. So basically, it follows Ollie and her friends, her two friends. What are their names? The names in here. Ollie, Coco, and Brian. There we go. As they first go on a school field trip, and their bus breaks down on the way home. They have to survive out there. Their classmates are kind of like taken over, possessed, sort of thing. And there's like creepy scarecrows all around, and they have to hide in small places to survive. And there's the smiling man who's very creepy. And I'm not doing a good job explaining this, but you should read it if you like creepy things. Similarly, not as creepy, this is more like a mystery. And that is the Malamander series. I've got the first two here, the next two are up there. So Malamander and Gargantus. I don't know what this series is called. Well, I've only got one more up there, Shadowgast. But there's another one out as well. There's a fourth one out. And basically, it's a kind of creepy creature called the Malamander exists in this world, and Herbert Lemon, or Herbie Lemon, lives in this hotel as the Lost and Finder, and he has to help this girl called Violet. I'm gonna be so impressed if that's right. I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, and Violet has lost her parents, so she's lost. She's lost. She wants to be found. It's up to Herbie to help her find herself. And it's got, yeah, creepy stuff along the way, and I keep putting this over here and it keeps making the colors very funny, so I'm gonna stop. So yeah, this one is about the Malamander, this one's about Gargantus, this one's more about the sea. Oh, it takes place on, well, it's Chirion Sea, but then the lights all get broken and it spells Eerion Sea. I think that's the name of the series, Eerion Sea. The penultimate ones that I have to recommend to you is the Pinch of Magic series by Michelle Harrison. Got the first two here, the second two up there, because I haven't read those, so I can only really recommend these two. Starting with A Pinch of Magic and then A Sprinkle of Sorcery. This follows. This is good if you want to read a sister story, because this follows three sisters, these follow three sisters on their adventures. A Pinch of Magic, there's like this curse where they can't leave the island. If they leave the island, something bad will happen to them. One of the sisters does leave the island, or two of the sisters leave the island, and then the third one has to come and help save them. And then they all save each other, and they all get like special gifts, and it's amazing. Some of my favorites again. And A Sprinkle of Sorcery just follows along when they can do stuff again. And then the final ones, probably the heaviest ones here. Ooh. It's a Tea Dragon Society by Kay O'Neill. Originally Katie O'Neill, that's why it's got a different name up on this one. But yep, they go by Kay O'Neill now. And this is the Tea Dragon Society. Then, oh, the Tea Dragon Festival. Yep. And the Tea Dragon Tapestry. And this is the whole series, or at least that's as much as I know. We'll start with the first one. We'll only do the first one because this is getting long. So the Tea Dragon Society is a graphic novel for children, and it's beautiful. It follows some people as they take care of their little tea dragons. Tea dragons are tiny little dragons that have that grow the leaves for teas, for different types of teas. At the back, they've got some of the different types. So you've got over here Earl Grey Tea Dragon, Hibiscus Tea Dragon, Ginger Tea Dragon, and Peppermint Tea Dragon. Look how absolutely adorable these are. And yeah, it's really good if you want to teach the child in your life about accepting others and accepting yourself, and yeah, not just, yeah, loving everyone and accepting people for who they are and not trying to change them. And it's beautiful. Kay O'Neill has done a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful job at this series, and I highly recommend. They don't come in these big hardbacks anymore, hardcovers, but I think that's just better because, like, then you can properly read it to your young one or read it yourself. It's a lot easier. And yeah, now these two shelves, which are my two middle grade shelves, they are completely wrecked. And that's the end of my recommendations. Okay, that's the end of the video. If you've made it this far into the video, let me know what your favorite book growing up was, if you were a reader. If not, what is your favorite book now? If you don't want to leave that, leave either a chicken emoji or a fox emoji for House with Chicken Legs and Eva Evergreen. If you can't see, there's a little firefox on here. Very, very cute. And yeah, if you made it this far into the video, please consider liking, commenting, subscribing, all that jazz. And I'll just see you in the next one. Bye bye.